going to give his first lecture on gravity and incoherence, but I saw that the second one also was incoherence and gravity.
That's right, we'll see. There's two parts of it, so we'll see how far we get. So thanks. It's very nice to be here. This is going to be the first lecture, a little bit in the spirit of what Mark was talking about. So I'm very happy. I think where Mark ended is more or less also where I want to dive in, a bit on the conceptual side. So I'm a theorist. I work in quantum optics and quantum information, who has strong interest in gravity and how what that means for actually quantum physics and whatever experiments we can do. So in this talk, what I mean with theory here, I will try to focus a bit more on the foundational and the conceptual aspects of some of this interplay, and especially in light of these kind of matter wave interferometers that Mark nicely introduced, and even showed the absolute cutting edge results in that field. So in this talk, I want to go a little bit first a step back, try to motivate some of these questions that you're asking that Mark already also even gave partial answers to. But to try to give a feel of why it's interesting to study the interplay between gravity and quantum systems, specifically in this type of laboratory regime, from a conceptual perspective. So this is kind of like a schematic overview of history of physics, very rough schematics. And physics has always been such that there is new phenomena that we discover, and after a while there is a certain unification that takes place where you realize that these are different aspects of one and the same thing. And so, for example, with Galilean mechanics, at some point we had electricity and magnetism, at some point these were combined, and then it was realized that in fact mechanics and electromagnetism combined to some deeper underlying theory, which is special relativity. From mechanics, also we of course discovered Newtonian gravitational laws. Now, on the other hand, in blue is quantum mechanics, which is very separate from the other types of theories that we had, and it seemed to be somewhat a little bit in a vacuum, even though it was necessary to explain phenomena that we didn't know or couldn't understand. It was very different conceptually from everything else that we knew so far. But with time, when you look at it closer, you can actually see how quantum mechanics actually can be combined with some of those things that we know. So for example, combination with special relativity, so relativistic quantum mechanics, allows us to understand electromagnetism in a quantized fashion. And that's the theory of quantum field theory. So there's always some kind of unification that allow us to understand what's going on the interplay between some of these seemingly distinct fields of physics, where there's actually an interplay, some possible new phenomena that can arise and give us deeper insight. Of course, Newtonian gravity also at some point was, 100 years ago, was combined with relativity to produce the general theory of relativity, which is Einstein's theory of gravity, generalization of Newtonian theory, and that's also a separate big aspect of it. And what is a big question for the last 100 years or so is the combination of those two. How can we understand gravity in terms of our quantized laws of nature, or vice versa, and what does it mean if you can or cannot do that, and what are the exact obstacles there? So I'm not going to talk about quantum gravity here, because this ongoing research field, so clearly just the fact alone that for 100 years we have an answer, there are some very deep, interesting underlying problems there, and maybe some of which we don't even fully appreciate. But what we instead can do is carve out small pieces of this interplay and see which types of questions we can understand and which types of topics we can actually study with current methods and can understand. So, to this respect, I separated the general relativity conception into two different parts. Of course, they're interrelated because it's one unified theory, but the two different parts describe two kind of different physical phenomena. So, one part is the geodesic motion, and what it means is just the particles themselves are moving on a background space-time which is curved. So that's one of the key aspects of general relativity. And this geodesic equation generalizes the second law, Newton's second law, to describe how particles move if there is some kind of curvature. And this curvature is encoded in this crystal surface here, which are functions of the gravitational metric. So the geodesic motion tells us how test particles, those that don't affect the space-time itself, how they behave, what the dynamics is, in the presence of gravity, in the presence of general relativistic effect. The second part of general relativity the gravitational field itself. And that's described by Einstein's equations of motion. So these Christoffel circles here, or the underlying metric, are actually dynamical variables themselves, and they're changing in the presence of matter. And this is described here on the right hand side. So if you have some kind of matter or energy content, this actually changes what the curvature is, which is all these symbols here on the left hand side, which are all functions of this G mu U, which are the metric tensors. So of course, there is an interplay between those two, because if the particles, they follow some kind of curved space-time, they're massive themselves, their own mass and energy changes the space-time, which in turn changes how they dynamically behave and so forth. So this is the field of like a full general relativity, and this is the source of this deep non-linearity in the theory. But in principle, these two things are two different physical phenomena. One is how particles move, and the other is how the gravitational field itself is sorted. And so the reason I separated that is just to clarify that there are certain questions that we can ask and actually answer with today's understanding of physics. So one example is we can look at quantum field theory and place it on a curved space-time without looking at this non-linearity. And this is the field of quantum field theory of curved space-time, which is a known research topic, and there's a lot of very interesting results in this field. For example, Hawking radiation. I think this is one of the most famous results in this aspect. Where it was shown that black holes actually radiate because of quantum mechanical phenomena. So, like I said, this is quantum field theory of curved space-time, and typically this is the aspect where people study, because we assume that when we look at general relativity, we have to go into a relativistic loop. And that's of course true in some sense, but what we can also study is we can study non-relativistic quantum mechanics in the presence of relativistic gravity. There's nothing wrong with that, because these two different regimes don't necessarily have anything to do with that, which it does. We can place an atom, which we can describe in non-relativistic terms, and place it into a highly curved, highly strong gravitational field. And we can still describe it without going into field theory. Because the field theory we only need if you're actually describing the quantum systems themselves, which are highly energetic. But we can take low energy systems and also study what they do in the presence of some kind of interesting gravitational curvature. And I call the quantum mechanics of curved space-time as opposed to quantum field theory of curved space-time. And that's a perfectly valid regime of physics in a small subset, of course, when you don't have particle creation or some other phenomena that take place in field theory. Okay, we can go even beyond that in principle, and people study that as well. We can look at the dynamics of the gravitational field itself and study that at the quantized limit, but only in a linearized regime. So this was first done already in the 30s by Bronstein, I think. It was largely forgotten for a long time because mostly because he sadly was executed by Stalin. He unfortunately shared the name with Trotsky, whose name was also Bronstein. So 2 years after his PhD thesis, he was just executed in one of these purges. And unfortunately, as often as the case, but with his death also his work was a bit forgotten. But it's likely being a bit rediscovered nowadays. He has very, very deep and very fundamental insights about the nature of the quantization of gravity and how that's different from the quantization of electromagnetic fields. And in the 30s, that was not obvious because everybody worked on the quantization of the electromagnetism. It still took another 10, 15 years until people understood that. And it wasn't clear that there's really a fundamental difference between the gravitational field equation and electromagnetic field equation in terms of their intrinsic nonlinearity. But he understood that, and he showed also that in the linearized regime, he can actually describe a quantum theory of gravity, and it works fine. So what this basically means is when you look at gravitational waves, we can also describe this in terms of individual gravitons. And there's nothing wrong with that. And that works as long as we don't take into this higher order terms into account some kind of deeper nonlinearities. And so there is, in that sense, a quantum theory of gravity in the linearized regime that we can work with. Okay. But we want, of course, eventually to go beyond that. And one way to do that is also to look at quantum gravity phenomenology. So that's a field of physics which I think is very exciting, but it's, of course, very speculative. The idea here is to, instead of solving the whole problem, to try to incorporate some potential behavior that we might expect from an underlying theory, incorporate that into the models that we know today, or into the physics we know today, and modify them slightly. So one example was already mentioned by in the previous talk, and that was the model by Milberg, I think. Coffrey, Newbern,
Taylor.
That's right, Jack Taylor, yes. Thanks. Yeah. I was trying to put the letters together, which way, yeah. Coffrey, Taylor, Newbern is just one example out of many models where there's a postulate that maybe there is some kind of new physics going on when you include quantum mechanics, where there's some self-interaction that changes the unitary evolution of quantum systems. But there's many other quantum gravity models. There's like changes of dispersion relation, for example, that people look for experimentally in like photons that come from distant stars. Maybe there's some effect of change of speed of light or some dispersion, which is anomalous, which could be a signature of some other light theory. So that's quantum gravity terminology. And then finally, of course, ultimately, and there's many, many smart people working on that, we want to find the theory of gravity. And that effectively is a combination of quantum field theory and general relativity with all these other things as like just special cases coming out. And because that is outstanding and still a challenge, it's interesting to look at some other elements. And in particular, where low energy experiments with AMO systems really can give an input is in these two areas, quantum mechanics on curved space-time and quantum gravity terminology. Are well suited to study to be studied in laboratory experiments with quantum systems that we can control very precisely and that we can measure precisely. And so in this talk, I want to focus on this aspect here, on one particular aspect of this interplay of quantum mechanics on curved space. Now, ultimately, I think what's interesting is to re-understand what type of experiments we can do to learn more about this interplay. But that is a bit of an unusual question usually, because there's many, many reasons why we should not be motivated to think about experiments. And they're often cited in one way or another in the context. And they are all of the very reasons that I'm going to show them, but they are a little bit unfortunate and they may discourage, or maybe have discouraged, some kind of other types of questions one could ask. So let me just go through some of these basic numbers that you can get from the interplay between quantum theory and gravity. So one of the most famous examples of like number discrepancies is the comparison between the gravitational force and the electric interaction. So if you take a proton and an electron, why? Because they're quantum systems, and this is in the quantum domain. If you take those and you compare their force, their interaction between them, electrically, to the gravitational force between them, you get like something 40 orders of magnitude discrepancy. In other words, like some kind of gravitational perturbations to atoms is something like on the order of 40 orders of magnitude away from regular quantum physics. So obviously, this is not something that even the best experimentalist can do. No offense, but probably it's going to be very hard. There's other numbers one can compare. For example, there's a famous Planck scale. So the Planck scale is a combination of all the fundamental concepts that we have that are giving us like a rough estimate of at what scales we might expect effects of the quantization of the gravitational field itself. Of course, we don't know if that's the correct scale, and we don't know what might happen, but it's clear that there is some kind of new physics that's going on at the very least of these scales. So in terms of in terms of distances, it's 10 to the minus 35 meters. In terms of time or frequency, it's something like 10 to the minus 44 seconds. Huge energies, 10 to 19 GeVs, so like 16 orders of magnitude above LHC. You can also define in terms of a mass. You can typically compare it to some mass of an elementary particle, so it's very large. So timekeeping, I don't know how well you can do, maybe 10 to minus 18 seconds, something of that sort. So this is many orders of magnitude away. And also position measurements, maybe if you take light or something like that, relative position measurements, it's still maybe 10 to the minus 19 meters. So again, this is 20 orders of magnitude away from experimental data. Okay. Then there's another effect that we know takes place that I mentioned already, is Hawking radiation. And if you compute what the temperature is of the radiation that comes out of a black hole, it's something like a nano Kelvin. A nano Kelvin for a black hole of a mass of about 60 solar masses. So these are the black holes that were observed by LIGO, for example. So black holes radiate will be very interesting to actually measure the properties of this radiation, but it's hopeless if it's a nanoKelvin somewhere in distant space, and we just compare it to a CV, and that's like 2.7 Kelvin something. Okay. There's also an interesting paper that recently was, names are popping out as a theorist that around the numbers but not names. So Freeman Dyson was the one that that wrote a recent paper maybe a year ago or so. He basically saying, oh, maybe we don't need to quantize gravity because look, if you want to look at even at single gravitons and we take something like LIGO, it's literally impossible to detect single gravitons. So if you plot LIGO's number, basically you want to measure a strain from a single graviton emitted far away, then the strain is something like 10 to minus 40. In LIGO, what they can detect is something like 10 to minus 22. So again, 18 orders of magnitude away. The picture here, apparently, you might realize a superhero who's called Graviton. That's the only thing that comes out of the Google image search. And finally, maybe a bit of an information theoretic perspective, because that's a very, very interesting perspective to think about quantum gravity. But in terms of experiments, maybe one number you can cite is the so-called Bekenstein bound. The Bekenstein bound tells us how much information content is physically possible to pack into a system of a certain mass. So it's an ultimate bound of how much information can exist in a certain volume. So it combines this kind of mathematical concept of information with real physical systems. And it's an ultimate bound in nature which can never be surpassed. And this is something like 10 to the 43 bits for a system of a kilometer size and a kilogram scale.
So even if I couldn't hope to detect a single graviton with LIGO, is there any sense in looking at correlations between points of time and the noise, and looking for like quantum correlations in the noise as opposed to looking for single gravitons?
Yeah, there are ideas in exactly that direction. Okay. So there are ideas, and they fall into this category of these phenomenological models. By Craig Hogan, so I even remember that name. Not Jason Hogan, Craig Hogan. I think he runs the Fermi Lab or something like that. And he had these models where there might be some anomalous noise in the gravitational background due to some quantum gravity effects. Not quantum effects, but really some speculative quantum gravity effects that might be visible there. So indeed, we could make experiments in that direction. But it's not, that would be a modification of physics. But there will be a signature one, and I think even they did already put stringent bounds on that. Yeah, but what you're saying goes exactly in the direction, basically, what is supposed to be the spirit of this talk, which is from these kind of questions you could, or kind of numbers, you can ask, does it at all make sense to talk about gravity in the quantum setting, especially in low energy tabletop experiment setting, when it doesn't seem obvious somehow that gravity should play any role at all in this case. So why even bother with something like that? And you know, okay, we can ask that. Of course, after the talk in the morning, it's kind of stupid to say that because we already have experiments that actually do that. But it's reasonable to assume that before you know what you can actually do with models. So to answer this question, actually, I think the first time there was actually a real interesting study in this direction was by an experimental physicist by Colleo, Overhaus, and Werner, where they started this whole business of atomic interferometry, of microwave interferometry, in the presence of the gravitational field. And that goes very similarly to the spirit that Mark already mentioned in the very last slide, which is that we can, you know, take the position that whatever we can compute easily also should take place, and there's nothing exciting about it. But then when you go back and think about this interplay, you can also think about, well, there's actually nothing that could even be observable in the first place. So where would we even expect new physics? So somehow it's contradictory if you say, well, whatever, you know, if you can compute it, there will never be new physics found, and that's kind of the end of all of experimental physics in general. So it makes no sense. And so these experimental physicists here, what they realize that you can actually do an experiment, and you can compute what happens in the presence of gravity in a quantum setting, and you can measure the effect of gravity. And here, this is just a schematic example of what's going on. It's basically just a matter wave interferometer without the details of how we actually make this path. And this is drawn here schematically like an optical interferometer. I mean, my background is quantum optics, so I like these type of drawings. So the idea is you have some kind of system, and then your system hits a beam splitter. What the beam splitter does is it splits it into a superposition of two different paths. And so now it goes along two different paths. So this little wiggles is supposed to show that there's it's a matter wave, so it can be a superposition of those two. And then on a final beam splitter, you recombine these two beams, and they go either into one port or into the other port, which is basically a projection onto the superposition basis with either a relative plus or minus sign between them. And then what you do is you just count the detection events on those two ports. And as you change some kind of relative phase, then also this detection probability on those two ports should change. And that is the signature of quantum interference. Because if it's just, if there's no coherence between those two, it will just be either all right on one detector or the other, or just half-half. But there will be no dynamic change between them. And now if you add the gravitational field from Earth's underlying Earth's, from Earth's gravitational field, if you add that into the position of the system, what you can basically do is just add an additional Hamiltonian, which is the coupling of the mass of the system to the gravitational potential. And of course, if you add this kind of potential energy to the system, and it's space dependent, what it does is it gives a relative phase to the system. So if it goes on a lower path, effectively the wave function evolves according to, you know, to some amplitude. On a higher path, it's a different amplitude. But in between those two, there is a relative phase. And this relative phase is governed by this gravitational potential. So in particular, if you're in a homogeneous limit, so if the gravitational force is exactly the same on both paths, still the potential is different. I mean, it's linearly different. So this is the homogeneous limit here with one and the same acceleration. Then this relative phase is mg delta x times t, so that's the time it takes to traverse these two paths, divided by h bar. And the trick here is that, of course, the gravitational coupling is very weak. Why is it weak? Because the mass, the gravitational charge, is extremely small. So for a neutron, something like 10 to minus 30 kilograms or something like that. But you divide this whole thing by h-bar, and h-bar is also very small. So the phase shift stemming from gravity is actually relatively strong. And in fact, it's so strong that at such a parameter, which is about maybe 10 centimeters high, you get about 20 interference fringes over a full rotation. So what you do is you change delta x by just rotating this interferometer. And as you rotate it, you change the probability of detecting these photons at one of the two detectors oscillate between those two. And so you see these oscillations, which are exactly the signatures of quantum interference fringes, as you rotate the interferometer. And this is actually experimental data taken from this first experiment, 1975, by Colello, Oberhauser, and Werner. And this was their setup. They just had cold neutrons, and they were Bragg reflection from some crystal. So they had like little crystal plates, which would split the system, then recombine the system on the middle one. And then here, this would be the final beam splitter here, where it would outside and detect where these neutrons would arrive. And so the size of this whole setup is something like 20 centimeters or something. So it's a simple setup, and it allows you to actually study the effect of gravity onto a quantum wave. And of course, this is the basic underlying principle of, you know, all of this technology we use today, including atomic quantums, where you actually see this gravitational phase shift between two distance amplitudes. And this phase shift shows as a quantum phase in between two amplitudes. And so you heard that we now have phase shift for separations of amplitudes of even up to half a meter. And of course, the larger the separation, the larger the phase shift. You can also use it for metrology, measure little g, for example, or even go beyond that, measure changes in g. So, you know, this could be g1, this could be g2, because you're now in the homogeneous limit. That's precisely what Mark was talking about in the most recent paper here. This whole thing started the realization that you can actually see gravity in a quantum interference setting in about 1975. And it's not that trivial. You can say, okay, we just added it, we know what happens, it's just regular quantum mechanics. But there could very well be the fact that you cannot add gravity in some way to quantum mechanics. Why should you be able to add just the gravitational interaction into the Schrödinger equation, just to do with other things? I mean, after all, it's some kind of limit of some space-time curvature. We don't know how to put it into a quantum setting. So there might be, you know, problems arising. Maybe you think it's the right thing and it's not really. And at that time, actually, there was some debate before this experiment whether at all you could ever see something of that sort. So what we learned from such experiments is that you can add gravitational potential, into the Schrödinger equation, it affects the quantum wave function coherently. So it's not just simply taking an electron and letting it drop in Earth's gravitational field, but there is a real quantum effect that is induced by the gravitational field, and that it remains quantum mechanical at the very end. In complete analogy to electric and magnetic forces that we have as well. But what we don't learn from this type of experiment here yet is the first part, which is to go beyond the Newtonian. So we know that gravity in a limit, like, you know, the lowest low energy limit reduces to Newtonian force theory, which is very similar to the Coulomb force. So we know how to deal with it. But general relativity has conceptually new effects to offer, effects which are completely different from any other forces that we know, because it's a fundamentally metric theory and nothing else is. So when you go beyond the Newtonian limit, there's actually some new effects you might be able to study, and then by a theory here, that have no analog in electromagnetism. And you don't learn from these experiments yet anything about going to the Newtonian limit. But I think in the years to come, there will be experiments that will be able to do that, specifically because we have these very large separations. And then finally, these experiments don't allow us to tell something about the quantization of the gravitational field itself. And that's because here, the gravitational field of the background Earth is assumed to be classical. So that's assumed just to be a fixed background, which is there. And the quantum effects of this field are not taken into account here, or are not relevant for the outcome of the experiment. Except for maybe some phenomenological models that may predict that maybe there is still something interesting there. But in principle, this does not necessarily prove the quantization of gravitational theory. But you can modify these experiments a little bit, and there were papers that came out in recent months where in two such interferometers next to each other, they actually also learned something about the quantization of gravity. So all these very simple setups, very simple kind of inducting experiments, allow you to gradually explore deeper and deeper into the regime where we really have to think hard about what it means to have gravity quantized, or what it means to have the interplay between quantum theory and gravity. Okay, so in this rest of these two lectures, I want to go beyond the Newtonian and show another type of questions we can ask with these type of matter wave interferometers. And in particular, I want to focus on one aspect because that was part of my research, but it's only one particular aspect of this interplay, which is how gravitational time dilation affects these type of interferometers and what new effects can arise. And now in the next two slides is just a very, very brief summary, very cartoonish summary of this entire effect, and it basically summarizes, you know, everything that there is to know about such things. The rest are just details and maybe special cases that one needs to study. So gravitational time dilation, very briefly, is just the following effect. If you have two initially synchronized clocks, and you place them at two different heights, then what happens is that after a certain time, they will actually show a different time. So they were initially synchronized, they should have shown exactly the same time, but they start taking different frequencies, such that you compare those clocks after a certain time, they will show different times. And in particular, the clock closer to the mass actually takes slower than the clock further away. So you probably all know that. To give you some numbers, I don't exactly know, but I think your feet are younger than your head by about 100 nanoseconds over your lifetime, something like that. So if you spend your entire life much, much closer to mass, you might actually, you know, gain some time as compared to your friends, who knows, who work at Goldman Sachs somewhere on the 50th floor. So in summary, the basic concept here is gravitational potential is not just simply a potential as any other potential. It has an additional effect which is unique to any other interaction we know to date in physics, and that is it causes the change of the time evolution. Okay, and then there's a second ingredient we're going to bring in, because like I said, what I'm interested in is this interplay between quantum theory and gravity. So this was the gravitational part we're going to focus on, and the quantum part is the following, it's the so-called quantum complementarity. And you all know what quantum complementarity is, maybe not in these words, because this is kind of Bohr's framing of words from 70 years ago, and it's not very popular anymore today. But the basic concept here is just very simple. If you have a double slit experiment, so you have some superposition that you create, so you have a particle shoot at the slit, and then you observe the interference pattern. Now you try to be very clever, and you say, well, we're going to measure which path the particle took. So you're trying to realize which way it actually went. quantum complementarity tells us that, and if you do that, there will not be mechanics, but trying to know which amplitude is actually taking place, and at the same time be able to still superpose the system and observe its interference. So quantum complementarity tells us you cannot simultaneously know the path of a particle and observe its interference. And no means in general that there is which way information. So it's basically just an inequality between how much which way information is there in the system and how much ability to be interfering there is in the system. Like distinguishability and visibility of interfering. Okay. So these are just the two concepts. And the bottom line of this entire, two lectures that I'm talking about and a bunch of papers is the following. Imagine how you do exactly the same as before. So in the gravitational time dilation case, we have two clocks, we synchronize them, we put them at different heights and compare them. But now you do that quantum mechanically with a single clock. So imagine you only have one clock, but now you put it in superposition at the different heights. So it's one clock, not two. But this clock has two possibilities, two amplitudes. It can be on the lower path, or it can be on the higher path. Or like colloquially, it's simultaneously there, here and there. Of course, it's not simultaneously there, it's just two possibilities that they are, but they are, define our classical equation. So now we have a single clock. But because of GR, we now know that the clock will take at a different rate on the lower path than it will take on the higher path. And because of quantum complementarity, we know that if there is any type of distinguishability between these two possibilities, then the quantum interference will vanish. So in other words, GR tells us that the clock will move differently, but quantum mechanics will tell us that there is no which way information, and it will affect the ability of this clock to show interference. So if you do the same thing, not with clocks, but just with any other matter wave, of course you will see here interference. But if you do that with clocks in the presence of gravity, the prediction is that there will be a change in your ability to see interference. And that's the whole summary. So, you can switch off from now on because you know the bottom line more or less, and the rest is just trying to understand this effect and add maybe some details to this and understand its implications. So in summary, this whole subject is the so-called interference of clocks, or like a quantum twin paradox or something of that sort. And the idea of that is that if you put a single clock, a single system in superposition that can measure time, what you're actually creating is not just simply two different heights which are in superposition, but you're creating the system to be in superposition simultaneously of being younger and older than oneself. And because of that effect, the observable consequences is that there will be actually a change in the path coherence of the system. Okay. Right, so I talked about clocks and quantum mechanics, and now let me just go a step back. Forget about these superpositions for a second. I said we want to study the interplay between quantum mechanics and gravity. And what I showed before is exactly this kind of spatial coherence that you have. But you can say, wait a second, we all know there are atomic clocks out there. We all know there's laboratories that use quantum mechanics to measure time already. So we have systems that are based on quantum mechanics that we use to measure time already. And what these systems do, they actually measure time exactly as it's predicted by relativity. So let me just very briefly guide you through this and then explain the difference. So for me, like as a very abstract theorist, somehow the atomic clock, I mean, it's a lot of very, very interesting physics going on. I just don't want to focus on that here, even though it would fit very well for this metrology setting, but because I want to more convey some conceptual aspects. But the basic ideas of a clock is that simply has to tick. That's the main thing. The other question is, how do you measure it? How well does it tick? And so forth. That's very important. But for a theorist, the clock has to tick. So what does it mean it has to tick? So imagine you have an atom and it has two levels. And initially, you are in some ground state of the system. Now, ground state doesn't tick. Ground state does not tick by definition. So a tick means that something is changing in time. If you're in a ground state, it means you're in an eigenstate of your Hamiltonian. So it means there's no generator of time evolution. When you're in the ground state, you always stay in the ground state. So the idea of a clock is if you have such an atom, then you create a superposition of the system of being in two different states. And you do that by applying the so-called pi half pulse, which is just a precisely timed interaction with a specific intensity of a laser field, which creates through the Marab interaction a superposition of the internal state. Now, superposition of a state is not an ideal state of Hamiltonian. And So I don't know. I think you're all relatively advanced. I probably don't have to go through like just the dynamics of a two-level system. I was thinking to just do that very briefly. But it's basically the idea that your superposition state here will evolve according to this Hamiltonian and will acquire a phase shift between the xi and the ground state of the system. So after a certain time, observation tau, what you do is then you basically project this superposition state again on either plus or minus relative superposition state, and you do that by applying another pi half plus, which projects the system, you know, to the xi from ground state, and then you just measure how many atoms in the xi state here. So this way, you're able to measure out this relative phase between this xi and the ground state of the system. And what you're measuring is this time evolution of the internal wave function. So you have an initial state of psi 0, and then it's evolving under this Hamiltonian H0. So if psi of 0 is an eigenstate of this H0, nothing happens. And if psi of 0 is a superposition of xi and the ground state, then you get a relative phase between psi. Unless you... If somebody wants to see like this kind of evolution of two-level system in 5 minutes, I'm happy to do that. I'm just not sure. Maybe it seems. I think you guys are pretty. Pretty these kind of quantum mechanical things pretty well. It's just sometimes good to revise them. But let me continue, and we can always go back to that if there is some kind of confusion. And please also ask any questions if you even very basic questions. And so some of what you think might be basic. Just to understand some basic conceptual. So like I said, the idea is that if you have an initial state, which is a superposition state, after a certain time, this time evolution, it will evolve to this kind of a state. And so this state is now a clock, because there's a dynamics going on, which depends on this time. So in other words, there is something in the state, which is time dependent, and which is measured. And it does that in this frequency, which is the transition frequency between these two levels. Now, here's the important part I want to stress. These type of systems are based on quantum mechanics. And what exactly is this tau? So of course, experiment is the duration that you're waiting before you initialize and read out your clocks. But tau conceptually is the proper time as it's predicted by relativity. Special relativity and general relativity, it doesn't matter. So how do we know that this tau that you're measuring is actually exactly the proper time? So from the theory side, it cannot be anything else. There's no other physical quantity which is measurable in terms of time. Proper time is the only operational physical time which is even in principle measurable. That is the prediction of relativity. So any system that evolves in time evolves only with respect to proper time. And proper time is a function of velocities, it's a function of gravity, it can be a function of different things, on trajectories that a particle takes, but that's the only thing that has physical meaning, proper time. But you don't need to take my word for that, because there are actually experiments that confirm that with quantum systems. And now, I talked about gravitational time dilation very, very briefly. Let me just go very briefly to show you mathematically exactly what gravitational time dilation means. So how do we find what the proper time is in general relativity? Conceptually, it's not hard, so we don't need the full kind of, fleshed GR complicated mathematical framework, because proper time is really just the four distance, which is the fundamental concepts in relativity, ds squared. And it's that if that four distance is negative. So if you have some kind of distance between different events, and in the relativistic setting this distance happened to be negative, what that simply means is that there is a time that passed from one event to another. And this time we call it proper time. So this is d tau. And we can compute that from just the equation for this four distance, which is the equation that includes the gravitational metric tensor. So in special relativity, it's just minus dt squared plus dx squared. But in general relativity, there are prefactors which capture the fact that time components and space components can have some kind of intrinsic curvature. So they can be stretched in some way at different way systems make. So if you just take a static metric, which just means you don't have to describe G, zero, I components. So this is, you know, GPU is a tensor which is a 4x4, has 4x4 components. But if you don't have to describe zero I components, then this is the expression for the format for the full proper time. So G zero zero times the change in the time evolution, coordinate time evolution, plus some spatial curvature times the changes in the spatial. So dt and dx are just coordinates. When I say just coordinates, it means we can choose what coordinates we use to describe it. And of course, this will also change what kind of, you know, associated curvature we have to describe it. So if you change from Cartesian to spherical coordinates, this literally just, this is, we have the Jacobian there, so you are changing, you know, Cartesian are, you know, exact 90 degree angles. If you change it to spherical coordinates, you're changing the angle, so changing the curvature in this sketch. Okay, so if you just write, you know, if you just use this equation, what we have is an equation for how proper time is changing as a function of just, you know, the coordinates we assign to the system. But there's this kind of additional prefactor here, which depends on all these curvatures, which is due to gravity, and it also depends on the velocities of the system. So again, this is just a very well known, especially in special relativity, where these g's are always just one. The velocity here is the coordinate velocity. So forget the velocities just for simplicity. So imagine the system is stationary in these kind of coordinates, so it doesn't move. Then these parts here are just zero. And what this equation tells us is that the proper time, the time that the system is actually feeding, depends on the G00 component of the metric. And the G00 component of the metric can be different in different spatial positions. In particular, if you take the weak field limit of general relativity, weak field limit just means that you expand whatever results you have to lowest order in c to the power minus 2. In the lowest order, where you only keep terms up to this order, the G00 component is always of this order. This phi here is just a regular Newtonian gravitational potential that we interpret in the Newtonian limit.
Sorry, what do you mean by stationary particle? Like stationary in one?
Stationary means that there's no coordinate velocities. So sitting on a table.
Which is in a particular frame.
It, of course, it's in a particular frame. So if I'm, let's say I am sitting on a table and I'm falling from the moon down, and I decide to describe it from my, you know, coordinates that seem natural to me. It doesn't matter which I use, but I just use my local coordinates. Then of course, as I'm falling down, this particle is kind of falling towards me, so it will have some velocity in this particular coordinates.
But you can boost to some frame with constant speed, as long as it's not accelerating. As long as the frame doesn't accelerate.
Well, I mean, you can also use some kind of accelerating frame. It's fine. You just have to be careful. You know, you just have to take everything into account. I mean, with the non-acceleration, just means all of these frames are equivalent, and you know the results are still always equivalent. You just have to be careful what you're computing. So I mean, even if you're accelerating, you know, you could still describe as a clock. So here, just for simplicity, let's say there's a clock standing here, and I'm standing next to it. So I'm stationary with respect to it, and I use my coordinates. Then that is what this means. But you can choose something completely different, and the result will never depend on. Okay, so let's take this metric, let's plug this in, and again expand to lowest order 1 with c squared. Then what this tells us is that the proper time at a certain position x2 is not the same as the proper time at a certain position x1, but it has this additional factor which depends on the potential at which this x2 is. So there's a difference in proper time which depends on the difference in the gravitational potential. So tau 1 is, you know, basically the coordinates or the proper time if you sit on the particle. So if you sit on the particle, then the old, you know, then d tau is equal to dt. It is tau 1. And then if you go away, then tau 2 has this additional prefactor 1 plus 5 and x2. So this is just all there is to gravitational time dilation. It just tells us that the proper time experienced by a certain dynamical system is different. Just as a side note, this whole thing can also be described in terms of energies as well. You don't need to talk about time necessarily. You just say, okay, maybe, you know, my energy is changing. And energy or Hamiltonian is just the generator of time. So it's just the inverse relation of this thing. I can say that the, you know, the generator of some evolution of a system far away from me has to have you know, this kind of additional G00 component with respect to some local generators that you have. So if I'm kind of local dynamics, this dynamics is described differently from in terms of an energy file. Okay. All right. So this is the expression for just gravitational time dilation. And how do you measure? Like I said, you have two clocks, and you synchronize them initially. So for example, you have like a year clock, and then you put another clock far away. They're exactly the same. You put it at two different heights. And now these clocks are now atoms, as I said before. And what it tells us is that atomic wave function in here, they evolve with respect to one specific proper time, just tau 1. And tau 2 is not the same, meaning that the wave function for, with respect to this internal clock evolves with respect to a different tau 2. So the tau in here can be different as described precisely by general relativity or special relativity, and it enters the wave function as this kind of parameter. And so, again, how do we know that? We know that from the fact that these clocks have been built from quantum systems. In fact, the first demonstration, or actually I think all demonstration of gravitational time dilation have always been done with quantum systems, with atomic clocks. And the first one was done with cesium clocks by Hafele Keating, where they literally did this experiment where they had a clock on an airplane that flew far away. It was microwave clocks. And they confirmed exactly this relativistic prediction. So in other words, what they really prove is not just simply that GR is valid and the proper time formula is correct, but they also prove that this formula can be plugged into this wave function of the atoms. So it really, that is what they observed. If you couldn't do that, the experiment wouldn't have worked. So in other words, everything works exactly this way.
And just to make sure, if you use the, I mean, the evolution in the minus I h naught tau, if you use tau, so right now your h, your Hamiltonian is mc squared. Is that true?
So if it's a clock, the Hamiltonian is not just as mc squared. So here, for example, this h naught would be this Hamiltonian here. So let's say I have an atomic clock. Then the H naught is the Hamiltonian for the superposition state.
Oh, because I'm thinking if you use proper time, then the frequency is constant.
No. Well, I mean, that's a separate question. So, I don't want to confuse you. So there's two different things. What you can do is, to this Hamiltonian, you can always add plus mc squared.
You can always do that.
Yeah.
And a constant.
Right, and there's always a problem. So you can add that as well. But what I mean here with H naught is this dynamical evolution of this degree of freedom inside here. So here your H naught is some operator. Not a constant, but an operator.
Okay, yeah, there. Okay.
You can add mc squared if you like.
Yes.
There's no problem. And yeah, you get also some local phase or delta phase or something like that. And I'll get to that in a second.
Sure, and one more question. Yeah, there are reasons we use tau naught t, like h naught t over h bar.
Right. So, exactly. So I already put here tau to clarify there's never a t. So we always write t, because we never think about relativity or gravity when we're doing these things. And then once we go into quantum field theory, we never think about these equations anymore either. But the correct physical thing actually here is always tau. It's never t. There's no such thing as t that is measurable. So whatever you measure is always proper time.
Oh.
There's no difference unless you make a comparison. So that's why we don't care. There's no difference unless we compare two systems that have a different tau. As long as all the taus are the same, those that we compare to, or we don't compare, then it makes no difference. So that's why we never think about it. But here I just conceptually wanted to clarify that what really is happening is that there's always a tau which is being measured. And that's precisely the types of experiments that do compare are, like I said, the ones with the cesium clocks, where it literally took two and they compare them. And they have exactly this type of atomic clock, and they do see exactly the evolution with respect to the proper time. Or more recently, like track ion clocks, some of the best clocks that you have, they also explicitly made this type of experiment. And they are so precise because they use optical frequencies and not microwave frequencies. And so the higher your frequency, of course, the closer together you can measure your time. So at shorter scales, you can measure your time. And that means they can measure this kind of difference in height separation by something like 33 centimeters. Today, even better. I mean, 8 years later, there's a precision much better. It's more on 1 centimeter scale, if you were to do such a comparison experiment. So, but to see that, you need a comparison between two clocks, and then see that they have evolved at a different rate. All right. So, okay. What I wanted to stress here, so I talked a lot about quantum mechanics and time dilation, but there's one aspect that of this interplay-linearity quantum mechanics is not tested in this. So here, my point was that the clock mechanism itself is quantum mechanical. So all the internal degrees of freedom, we need quantum mechanics to describe it. But that's it. We don't need quantum mechanics for anything else. For the purpose of gravity, for the purpose of these positions, or something more where this proper time is, everything is completely classical. Just as some system, you're agnostic about what its internal mechanism is. You don't care that it's described by quantum mechanics. This system experiences a certain well-defined classical proper time. And then you have another system, and it experiences another well-defined proper time. So it is not quantum mechanical in that sense. In the sense of those degrees of freedom on which gravity acts remain classical. So the position degree of freedom here is always just that classical, because these systems themselves, when they are in the gravitational field or their velocity or something like that, do not show quantum mechanical behavior in this type of experiments. So what these type of experiments do not test is what really is interesting, which is the quantum dynamics on curved space-time, or you know, some quantum theory on curved space-time effects. Because for that, you would need some kind of quantum system which is delocalized over an area where you cannot just assign a single classically well-defined word line. Okay. So let's try to do that. Let's try to find the results and see what happens for when you don't have a well-defined word line.
So in general, to go back to the slide, is the H naught of the system, it need not be time independent. Could be in a very general quantum mechanics time dependent, then it seems like it really matters in which frame you describe the time dependency.
It can be time dependent, but it's always effective, of course. So I mean, no Hamiltonian is fundamentally time dependent, but the time dependence comes from some interaction with something that, you know, maybe you're driving your system with something else and you know you don't want to describe this whole thing, so you effectively have some kind of Hamiltonian. So you're right. And you can add all these things. You just have to be careful. But in principle, it can be time dependent here. It's no problem. The only thing you have to do is now you have to have an integral. And you just have to make sure that you integrate over over the correct path of the system. So you can also integrate over the Hamiltonian. It can be time dependent. So you don't just multiply by tau, but you have d tau. It's still this time dependence. As long as it's localized on whatever world line it is, it will have exactly the same proper time evolution as the system itself. So let's say you have a box, and inside of it I do something such that the Hamiltonian is time dependent. Still, that has a well-defined proper time, which is corresponding to this position in a gravitational field. And the same box far away will have another well-defined proper time. So the Hamiltonian can be time dependent. It's no problem. Okay. Where it gets complicated is if, you know, it's kind of delocalized, or not delocalized, but you have to like look at, you know, maybe you're shining from far away, it has a different proper time, so you have to then take into account how everything is building. It's just you have to be careful, but there's nothing conceptually different.
Is your last point here that in the clocks example, you have two separate quantum systems that are, you're bringing them far apart, and now you want to look at a single quantum system that has coherent superposition states that are separated?
Yeah, that's exactly right. Right. That's exactly right. It's like the difference between a double slit experiment and like two atoms that I could make. That's exactly right. And the reason to go that path around is precisely to see how quantum dynamics is affected when you have a quantum delocalization of a region of space-time which is non-Newtonian, so non-flat. So again, to go back to this kind of a cartoon example, now with a little more details, if you have this kind of interference experiment with a matter wave, and now this matter wave is also a clone. So imagine an atom like we had before, and this atom can be in two different heights, like an atomic interferometer, but it also has two different energy levels, which are in a superposition state. So it acts as a clone. So this type of system, we put now in a gravitational field, and it has superposition to different heights. And then again, now you look at that, just this detector counts on those two models. So the point is that you have a single clock that's positioned to path, and its clock states are now affected differently depending on which path they are, because the proper time is different according to those two paths. And so here is the crucial effect that takes place, which is new. And that effect is that general relativity now starts entangling these two different degrees of freedom. This is something that does not take place classically, and this is something that does not take place in Newtonian physics alone either. And this is the new aspect of this interplay, which is crucial. So because you have two different degrees of freedom, and both are now different depending on where they are, according to quantum mechanics, these degrees of freedom must be entangled with each other. This is due to the linearity of quantum mechanics. This takes only place if you really include effects from GR. So schematically before, we just had like a superposition between lower amplitude and higher amplitude and relative phase. Now, we still have the same. We still have a relative phase. It might even be the same relative phase. But there's one additional aspect which is conceptually different, which is you're now entangling these internal degrees of freedom, which are denoted in green. And all the external degrees of freedom are denoted in red. So you have this entanglement because this lower C's are different than this upper C's. In other words, you can look at the overlap. So let's say you trace them out. And if you trace them out, then this kind of function here, the overlap between those two, will be a prefactor of any interference pattern that you're looking observe for those two. So the overlap between those two is what we call the visibility. So you can look at the superposition basis. You can look at the off-diagonal basis of the system. And the off-diagonal elements of the system will have this element in front of them. So usually it's one, because either we don't have any C's at all, or they're decoupled, or whatever. Like usually we don't care about additional degrees of freedom. But because of gravity, they are actually in different states, and they can be smaller than one. The fact that they're smaller than one is exactly capturing the which way information I talked about. So the which way information about the system's coherence is now encoded in the difference in the internal states. So the change in visibility is just the same as having which way information of a clock. And this inequality I mentioned is just the visibility square plus the distinguishability between those two states squared. So if the visibility goes down, it means the distinguishability of these two states becomes higher. So if they're completely distinguishable, you can never have interference. Okay. So what is this function of visibility? So that was just like on an abstract level. What is this visibility? And it's actually relatively straightforward without any deep mathematics, without going into GR or even quantum mechanics on with relativistic corrections. We can actually immediately write down what's going on from the concept that I showed you before. So like I said before, imagine you have a two-level pattern. It's ticking, so it's our clock. So these internal states here are evolving according to some proper time. And they will go, here below us, they will evolve according to a different proper time. I showed you the form of this proper time for a specific case, which is the gravitational time relation. But it doesn't matter because this, this Schrödinger evolution will always be with respect to some proper time, no matter what it is. Okay? And here's the trick. If you know that quantum mechanics is linear, and you believe quantum mechanics remains linear, also in regimes that we haven't tested, then what we can simply do is we just can sum those two things independently. We know that if we have a superposition, what it basically means in quantum theory is that we can just treat one independently of the other. They have nothing to do with each other. And then we can sum them coherently between each other, and that will be our correct result. It's completely trivial what I'm saying, but it's insanely powerful because it's often forgotten once you start going deeper and so forth, that this is a way to actually compute things which would otherwise be hard to compute. You can just forget the fact that you have quantum mechanics or anything of that sort. You can just treat individual aspects like Feynman paths just individually between each other, and then just add the result out. And this will be the correct answer to quantum mechanics. So we just have the superposition of this different proper time of evolution, and that's allowed by inheritance. So not just individually, but we can have like, you know, a unitary of tau 1 plus unitary of tau 2. That's also you know, perfectly allowed state in quantum. Okay, so now, having said that, we know exactly how to compute this visibility of C now and C up, and that is just the overlap between those two. C of tau 2 overlap with C of tau 1. So if you write it out, it's C of 0, you know, times this unitary u dagger of tau 1, and here it's u times C 0. So it's just this overlap. Or just rewriting exactly the same thing, what it is an expectation value with respect to the initial clock state of the unitary evolution of the system with respect to its internal Hamiltonian, but also with respect to the difference in their proper times. So that is the function for visibility. It's a very, very simple formula, and that's extremely generic and a very, very powerful formula. Why is it powerful? Because it completely doesn't specify what this internal Hamiltonian H0 is. It can be what you said, some tiny pen Hamiltonian. You can add any complexity in there, whatever you want. The form of this formula must always be exactly the same unless you're breaking quantum linearity, which means you're breaking quantum mechanics, and that's a different story. But this form will always be exactly the same. And it's also powerful for this red part of this expression, because we haven't specified even what exact paths we were talking about. So I told you that there's a rotational time relation for this specific case, but here this tau 2 and tau 1 can be completely arbitrary. So you can do this unitary evolution in a black hole or outside, you can, and here it, the result will be exactly the same. Unless maybe there's additional effects that take place, but this tau can be anything, and it captures anything you do with the system. So in other words, you can now have a complicated experimental setup where you really look at how to exactly prepare the superposition state, how to fold them, how to shoot them up, everything like that. And all these details are extremely important, and they intrinsically enter this formula, but they don't change it. And they enter the formula in the sense that the only thing you need to know at the very end is what was the proper time that was experienced by the system. So no matter what the experimental details, in the very end, you know it will give you a certain path. And you have a certain path in space-time that gives you velocity profiles, you know, and spatial profiles. Once you know that, you know exactly the tau, just by computing this, you know, what I showed you, ts squared. You just compute that for your specific experimental path that you have, and then you just plug it in here. So the formula doesn't change, because it's completely arbitrary with everything. And just to give you an example, and I think I will probably end here, so this was maybe a bit abstract, but it's only abstract just to show that it's very simple, and there's nothing extremely strange or complicated when we add actually gravitational phenomena to post-internal phenomena to quantum theory. So let's take again our two-level system as we had before. Again, we have this two-level Hamiltonian, right? And also, you know, certain energy in the ground state, certain energy in the excited state, it has certain energy. And so because it's in a superposition state, it evolves with this frequency, which is the difference between these two energies. You just buy it in here, it's really just an overlap of those two evolved states. And then the result of that is also, it's quickly to derive, is this kind of cosine, or absolute value of this cosine. Okay, but yeah, so I think the rest I'll probably going to do tomorrow, but I hope to have convinced you that this, you know, this formula can be derived in a very, very simple manner, simply by acknowledging that quantum systems evolve with respect to proper time, and that superposition of a quantum system with respect to different proper time is what is exactly predicted by quantum theory. All right, thanks.
Questions for you?
At some points at, where, let's say, the acceleration, at one level they have one acceleration and another they have different, and we know what happens when they stay in these accelerations, and what happens to the system when they are going from one place to another, like they are changing the acceleration. of the entire evolution there. In exactly the same way. So you, what you're talking about is, let's say, I took a special case where they're stationary. So let's say they're not, and they're moving around. You know, like an atomic fountain, they start somewhere, they move up, they move down, somebody else, you know, so the other amplitude goes in the lower path. What you just have to do is you have to integrate this proper time along the path that you're taking. And what happens here is you just keep track, okay, what is the, you know, what is the gravitational potential at each position? And what is the velocity profile of your system? And so you just integrate that over the path. It's very simple in principle. Of course, you can have very complicated paths and things like that. But what you just do is you integrate what is the overall proper time that you are experiencing from the beginning until the end of your experiment. So just to add one small thing, it's a good clarification. Just to add, you said what I showed here are different accelerations. So often a misconception, and just to clarify, I hear it very, very often, gravitational time dilation takes place even if you have the same acceleration. So the force does not need to be different. You have the exact same acceleration, because gravitational time dilation depends only on the potential. And the potential is a little gx in the homogeneous limit. So you can have gx1, gx2, it's the same g, but there's a time dilation. So the gravitational redshift does not need different accelerations. It can have, if you have different accelerations, you have even more time dilation, even better. But it depends already on the difference in the potential as opposed to the difference in the force.
Question. So let's look at the Bolzmann equation. Since the gravitation potential is after at any constant integer, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, so if I add a constant here, it seems, I add a constant for phi at position x2, then the relationship between tau 2 and tau 1 will be different.
You have to be careful here, tau 1. So you can do it. Let's say you start with here, and you just use the tau. The only thing that happens is the difference in the gravitational potential.
Oh, I think here you should, you may want to write x2 minus.
No, because what I assume is already I sit. So tau, what is tau 1? Tau 1 means I sit on the system, and there, this is where I put the gravitation potential to be zero.
Okay.
Yeah. So tau 1 is the local, local system where my local coordinates are, and that's my zero.
Oh, that's your origin.
Yeah. So if I wrote t here, then this would be tau 2 minus tau 1, and then 5 x 2 minus 5 x 2.
I could be missing something lately, but it seems like you're doing the evolution of them along two different paths, but not bringing them together.
Yes.
Because they have to both meet at the same place.
That's exactly right. That's extremely crucial, very, very important. To even be able to talk about anything like that, same in GR and the same in quantum mechanics, is that you have to have an operational, well-defined meaning of comparing two things. It's crucial in GR for other reasons than in quantum mechanics, but they're both crucial. You don't have absolute synchronization in GR. It's meaningless to talk about system far away and system here, precisely because of the curvature of space-time. The only thing you can do is you have some way to compare it. Let's say you send a signal down towards where you are, only then can you make a meaningful statement. Otherwise, it has no physical meaning, literally no physical meaning. There's no absolute space or something like that, like absolute notion of simultaneity or absolute notion of any other thing. It's the same in quantum mechanics. Like, if I have a superposition state, it has no, what does it mean? Is it coherent or not? I mean, it has no meaning unless you measure it, bring it together. So here, it is intrinsically assumed that that's exactly what it is. So, not here, of course, this is just mathematics, but here. In the comparison of those two clocks, it's assumed that we bring them apart and we come them together. And there's a contribution from this bringing apart and bringing them together to the proper time as well. So, for example, you change, somebody, let's say you have one clock on the table. Now you lift one up. So you have like a certain time you lift it up, you give it some velocity. So that will contribute. Then later, when you lift it down, that will have an additional contribution. Now, this is neglected here just for simplicity, because you can do that. It can be arbitrarily, you know, there's some contribution, it's constant. And then you can weight arbitrarily long. So you can make the ratio between these contributions arbitrarily small. But for example, in these experiments, you know, of course, also here, but especially here, you took all contributions to account because they're on a, here it was an experiment with a clock on Earth and one on an airplane. So you lifted, actually they didn't take into account lifting in their airplane because, you know, it was like a world, like around the world trip, so it takes ages as compared to lifting. But you take into account the velocities it's going and different, you know, different altitudes. So you're right, you should exactly integrate along the exact path from beginning till the end, and they have to meet initially, and they have to meet in the end. Otherwise, you get into huge just nonsense that you can come out. And there's a lot of discussion. Actually, in the second part of my talk, I talk exactly about this. I have some space-time diagrams to show that. But yeah, thanks for the clarification.
So you don't have some like weird twin paradox thing?
Exactly. You can. Yeah, that's exactly right. So this is how we get into paradoxes or seemingly strange answers when you are comparing things which have no physical meaning.
Maybe I missed this, but you, in one of the subsequent slides, you mentioned that the time dilation entangles the state of the clock to some internal degrees of freedom which you labeled as C. Are these just abstract degrees of freedom, or do you have, is there like a concrete example of one thing?
It's these two levels. So one concrete example, it could be both, but here they are abstract in terms of, because I want to keep it general. But just in a concrete example, let's say internal two-level systems, G plus E. So let's say you have like initial wave function at a specific position, okay? And then now you have also, let's say this is external, and this is internal. So you have a position of your atom, that's x0, and then you have these two levels inside of the atom, electron. And it's at like, you know, superposition of two different orbitals. Okay, so this is your state. It's a product state. You know, it's a product state. What this tells you is that from the GR, what it does is that your system, when it goes to x1, what this system will evolve to is b plus to the delta E so now you bring it at a certain position according to GR, this time dilation formula in the lowest limit. It evolves according to proper time. And what is the proper time? It's this, you know, so this is the frequency of the system, delta E is the energy difference. It evolves with this redshifted frequency, or you can do 1 plus, but I, you know, there's some low base to identify, doesn't matter. So there's a redshifted frequency which depends on the position. That's for one position. But now, if you put it in a different position, you have a different internal frequency because you have a different redshift with which you're evolving. So you're redshifted by a different amount, which is x2. Or in other words, let's say you sit on x1, you don't see a redshift. But then if the guy comes from x2, you'll see that that guy with respect to you has a redshift. So between those two phases with which this internal relative evolution is evolving, there is a shift because they're going at two different frequencies. But this state, so this is what I call C2. And this is what I just, in an abstract way, call C1. These can be anything. It doesn't have to be a two-level system. It can be a billion-level system. It can be some complicated evolution, even evolution you don't know. It doesn't matter. But if it's a two-level system, we know exactly what happens. And this is these are the two states. But importantly, they're not the same. So now C1 and C2 are not the same. They're not the same, so you have to take this overlap. So they are, you know, E plus G, right? So those two and those two. But then they have this this additional then they have this additional prefactor of the GG, which is E to the I delta E over H bar delta X G C squared. And I forgot one of square root. So not equals 2, I guess, in my non-normalized way. So if there was no such effect, this would be exactly divided by half, exactly 1. But now there's this additional effect. So you know this is 1 plus this cosine delta E over H bar delta X G over C squared E plus I and the sine of that thing. So this is precisely that. If you take the absolute value of that thing, you square it, you add it, then there's a trigonometric formula, so then you get a half here. So omega delta tau. So this difference here, delta x g c squared, is precisely delta tau for this specific case of gravitational translation of homogeneous. So this C2, I'm sorry if it was a bit too abstract. I really meant to mean this is exactly physically dynamical evolution of something that's going on inside the system. It's really like two levels or three, or spin. It can be some precessive spin or something like that inside the system. And so you can plug it here, whatever your favorite kind of timekeeping system is, or an oscillator, just a harmonic oscillator. And these two states, whatever states you use to measure time, they will always be different. Will have some phase shift with respect to each other, or even much more Borg-Kong
I think you're already beginning to see the difficulty when you bring in gravity into quantum mechanics, the simple confusion. You have C for the speed of light, G for the gravitational constant, G for the ground state, C for the system.
That explains the half.